Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is my job right now to make sure that after this productive morning and a very nice lunch, nobody falls asleep for the next 45 minutes. We'll see how I manage. I will talk today about a particular kind of technologies for learning, particular kind of systems for learning, adaptive intelligence systems, systems that can, in personalized way, maintain the instruction process for the learner, and they do it through understanding the learners better, through addressing their particular misconceptions, knowledge, strengths, weaknesses, and so on and so forth. The particular topic that I will tackle within this field is how adaptive systems, adaptive learning systems, can and should support the content offers that it enhance the systems with extra learning material, with extra learning objects, because for decades, this particular challenge hindered the wider deployment and wider adoption of these systems in real classrooms. I will start maybe by stating the obvious. So our educational system right now operates under a lot of stress, right? We live in the environment which is under explosion of knowledge. So the new technologies evolve and appear every day. Students have to learn much more than they ever had to before. Students have to prepare for professions that may not even exist at the moment. Yet they have to somehow obtain the skills that will be necessary for them during this. During their professional career. We also live under the forms of content. I mean, internet is a source of, well, practically definite amount of content, right? And also educational content, textbooks, tutorials, interactive examples, exercises, all of these actually can be found online for most of the subjects in the world. So the challenge, of course, is how we can help students to find the proper learning material on the online, right? It's nice that we have so much content, but it's also a problem that students don't know where to find it or which way material is good for them at the moment. We also operate under the explosion of students, and not only just the sheer quantity of students, right? I mean, so we have right now much more students than in the colleges than we ever had, but also the diversity of students. I mean, many current workers have to go back to classrooms to return during their career. Many students have a need. Have a need to get education, let's say, anytime, any place. I mean, so the diversity of learning scenarios, the diversity of receivers of learning is also increasing each day. So the question is, of course, how our classrooms will keep up with this. And, well, I'm a technology person, right? I'm a head of the lab for intelligent learning technology, so my answer is intelligent learning technology. So why? They can maintain the personalized online learning experience for basically every student in principle, right? So they do it by tracking student progress, by understanding the individual differences and strengths of the users, of the students, and by providing individualized learning experience to them. Now, what it enables them to do is essentially to serve as economically effective alternatives, oftentimes assistance, to a human teacher, in some, not all, but in some learning scenarios. Now, over the years, there have been multiple technologies developed that go under the umbrella of adaptive intelligent learning technologies, right? So it can be intelligent problem support, intelligent problem solving support, adaptive sequencing and coordination, adaptive mitigation, presentation, recommendation, and so on and so forth. So there's a plethora of approaches, mechanisms, technology systems that is available these days. Let me just maybe give a couple of examples how the technologies might look like when students actually use them. For this, I will use the platform that we have developed in my lab. The platform name is MathBridge. It is an online service for mathematical courses that students can take on their own or as a part of the university education. And especially, it is a platform which makes a lot of mathematical bridging content available. Bridging content is the content that students who just entered colleges need to take in order to level their mathematical competencies with the requirements of college-level mathematical course. And MathBridge implements this in particular intelligent adaptive technologies, intelligent problem solving support, adaptive course generation, and adaptive navigation. By the way, this afternoon we'll have a dedicated talk about MathBridge, and Eric Andres will deliver it. So anybody who is more interested in this topic is welcome to join. I will really just briefly describe what the digital interface of the system looks like. So this is the digital interface, right? I mean, so it has three main panels. The left panel, which is used to navigate through the core structure. The central panel, which is used to present the material of the course, and the right panel, which is used for some service features such as search, social feedback, and so on and so forth. So let's take a look more in more detail on the left panel. So MyBridge can serve traditional static courses, right, which would be the same for everybody. It can also generate personalized courses. What it means is that if two students generate the same kind of course for the same learning needs, the course actually will look differently for the students. Why? Because the learning model of the students will be different for the MyBridge. It also shows these progress indicators. And these indicators, they actually show the progress of the students within the course and help to navigate the student to the right piece of learning material at this particular time. Another technology is intelligent problem solving support. And here you can see that we have an exercise the student needs to solve. Essentially, it needs to compute the derivative of a certain function. And while entering the steps of this exercise, you can enter correct and incorrect steps, and the system will intelligently provide feedback for these steps. By tackling particular misconceptions that the student has exposed in this session. Now, how MyBridge actually does that, right? So what are the components, what are the solutions, technical solutions that help MyBridge to achieve such adaptive intelligent behavior? Well, as I said, I mean, there are four of different adaptive systems, but for most of them, the architecture really boils down to a set of standard components. So we have a student who interacts with instructional content within the system. Now, of course, system logs the interaction between the student and the content. This content can be really, I mean, exercises, interactive examples, tutorial pages, it can be anything. The thing that makes the system adaptive and intelligent is the description of this content with certain characteristics, with certain properties of this content, which is usually presented as a metadata. What it allows system to do, once you associate the characteristics, pedagogical, semantic, different characteristics of learning content in the system, it allows the system to reason about this content in terms of its qualities. Right, so now, no longer the system simply knows that this is an exercise, but it knows that this exercise has a certain difficulty, it is about certain concepts in the domain, it has a prerequisite which is a certain example, so the system can actually intelligently structure the learning experience of a student with this learning material. Now, by tracking the progress of a student with this now adaptive learning content, the system actually can infer some more information about the student. It can understand whether the student knows a particular concept or not, whether he has a particular misconception or not, whether he is ready to receive a certain exercise or not. And this information is usually stored in the user model, right? Most of the time, this user model is represented as an order weight over the domain model, over the domain conceptualization, which is within the system. Which means, let's say we have a bunch of concepts. If we talk about fractional arithmetics, let's say we have a concept about adding fractions with common denominators, adding fractions with non-common denominators. And the system can, through students' activity with the exercise within the system, ensure what are the knowledge of the student for this concept or that concept. Thank you. Well, now to kind of, you know, group it all together, of course, we also have a pedagogical model. A pedagogical model actually is the one which is responsible for adaptation, right? So it usually is represented as a set of some pedagogical rules that utilizes the domain knowledge, the user model, the metadata of the content, all of this together, and based on some pedagogical strategies, delivers content to the student in an adaptive way, either by placing these progress indicators, or by structuring the course in a particular way, or by providing a particular feedback which is tailored towards the characteristics of this particular user. Now, so this all sounds nice, right? I mean, so these systems have been built and evaluated over the years. More than 40 years of research. First systems of this kind have been developed in the end of 60s, beginning of 70s. Since then, dozens of conference series have been conducted. Hundreds of systems in multitude of domains. It's easier to find the domain in which the system has not been developed and to list all the domains in which they have been. Thousands of papers, thousands of researchers, basically a lot of active research going on. The problem is the technology space mainly in a lab. It is not widely adopted, besides some notable examples, it is not widely adopted in the classroom. And it is especially disappointing since the whole idea of personalization, the whole idea of systems that are capable to understand the users and to tailor their behavior in an assistive way so that the user can get a little bit more than, you know, just one size fits all system. It all started in e-learning. First systems, first adaptive intelligence systems have been developed for instructional purposes. And now we have Google, Microsoft, Facebook that make millions and billions of dollars by applying personalization techniques in their domains. And in e-learning, which is the origin of these ideas, we don't really have that many practical systems used in everyday classrooms. Well, the main reason for this, as I told you already, is that it is very hard to create new content for these systems. It is very hard to customize them. It is very hard to extend them, which means if a teacher wants to use the system and he needs to tell it a little bit about the curriculum of this course, he either cannot do this because the system is this black box, which is not allowing to do any changes with it, or he has to invest lots and lots of time in acquiring a lot of necessary expertise in order to modify the system towards his needs. So let me talk a little bit more about this burden offering. I mean, offering of learning content in general is a very hard procedure, right? It is tedious, it is expertise consuming, it is poorly supported most of the time. So the author of instructional content actually has to invest a lot of efforts in order to create even a single course. In the beginning of 2000, Stephen Downs evaluated that a typical university course is cost $100,000, the material of the course. I don't think the price went down from there. Well, when we add intelligence and adaptivity to the picture, the problem actually magnifies. The problem extends multiple times. Because not only now the author has to know what to teach and how to teach, he also needs to know how to dissect the learning material into individual pieces, into learning objects, right, so that system can actually provide this segmented instruction to the student. He has to know how to evaluate, how to annotate these learning objects with metadata. He needs to understand what is the conceptual structure of the domain, why this metadata is necessary, how it's going to be used. So he needs to know have some expertise of knowledge engineering. He needs to know metadata standards, all of this, right? I mean, so all this is a lot of work, a lot of effort. And the practices of offering for these systems have been improved over time, and so dedicated offering tools have been developed, but the problem is that these tools, most of the time, have been developed by the experts for the experts. They were not targeted towards non-expert users that actually can take care of wider adoption of the system, right? Take care of customization of the system towards their own needs and giving the system to their own students. And so the situation actually is much worse than it was before, because of offering. And there is something very unnatural about this picture. So the paradigm, the philosophy, if you will, that we are trying to implement in our lab is that, look, these systems, they are very smart, intelligent pieces of software. They have lots of models, lots of knowledge, lots of cool and sophisticated machinery, which help them to effectively support students, which help them to effectively guide students in the right way towards mastery. But for some reason, these systems are not capable to support the authors of the content, even though the knowledge about the offering and knowledge about the this content when it is delivered to students is essentially the same piece of knowledge. So our idea is that the knowledge that exists in the system can actually help us to to add extra knowledge to the system. That information and models which system already have, they are no longer an offering burden for the new authors, but they can become a vehicle to create new models, new content, new knowledge in the system. And the situation becomes a little bit more natural, right? More effective. So this is how it should look like. But the model that we already have in the system can actually facilitate creation of extra learning material. Let me exemplify this with two particular technologies we have developed in our lab that essentially try to take advantage of this internal architecture of intelligent tutoring system and in automated way help the authors to effectively perform certain offering tasks. So the first example is the calibration of exercise difficulties. And the technology that we're basing this research on is educational data mining. If you don't know what educational data mining is, so field of educational data mining, data analytics, it's a new field of research which essentially uses a set of technologies, approaches, methods to make use of extensive logs that modern e-learning software can store, and try to find within these logs interesting patterns, try to use these logs in order to improve the system, try to use these logs in order to communicate some interesting information to the teacher or to the student. And we use educational data mining to help us improve the offering practice. So, difficulty is yet another metadata. So we have exercises, right, and some exercises can be easy, some exercises can be hard. Depending on whether it's easy or hard, the system might decide whether to give this exercise to a student or maybe to hold a little bit because he's not ready for this. Right, well, and of course, estimating difficulty is not easy. Right, for different reasons. First of all, the author of an exercise, when he estimates the difficulty, he needs to estimate it for a totally different population of users. So students who will be solving this exercise, they have very different knowledge about the domain than the author who is creating this exercise. It's not an easy task to step into someone's shoes, right? Another thing is that many aspects influence the actual difficulty of an exercise at a particular moment. What if this exercise about this concept has been used before? Right? What if exercise of this type has been used before? I mean, what if exercise is not in the introduction of the topic, but rather part of the post-topic practice. How difficult will be the same exercise will very much depend on in which particular part of the course this exercise was presented to a student. Another thing is that often learning objects are reused, right? I mean, so it has been created by one person for one context, and then it is reused by another person in another context. If the university teacher that annotated exercise is easy for a bridging course, then the classroom teacher might think differently about this difficulty when he presents this exercise to a classroom, to school children. And the problem is that if the exercise difficulty is estimated poorly, it leads to a mismatch between the ability of a student to solve an exercise as the system thinks and the actual student ability. And it can lead to two different situations, right? For example, if a sequence of easy exercises is given to a very capable student, well, we'll have a bored student. So he will have no challenge, learning will be not effective for him. From another perspective, if an exercise or sequence of exercises, which are too difficult for a student, are presented to the student, right? So he is not that capable. This might lead to anxiety. Once again, not really effective learning. So what can we do? Well, if you look at these things a little bit more closely, so basically there is a mismatch between the estimated student ability, which is necessary to solve an exercise, and the actual student ability. Well, the good thing is that we have lots of information in our system that can help us to correspond these two together. One thing is that we have very rich logs that basically store all the activity, all the history of attempts for these exercises for past students. Another thing is that we have a lot of knowledge models that can help us and knowledge model mechanisms that can help us to retrospectively predict the student's ability while they solve an exercise on every attempt. So what we get as a result, I will not go into details about this because it was for the last presentation at some point, but at the end, what we have is for every exercise, we have a log of attempts. And not only we have the actual fact that the exercise had been solved correctly or not, but also the prediction by the system whether this particular student would have been able to solve that exercise or not. And this helps us to correspond the predictions and the actual history. And as a result, we can plot this history on this particular Gardner space and build so-called item characteristic curve, which corresponds the ability of a student and the probability that he would solve an exercise. It's the integral part of the item response theory, which we apply in this research. And it helps us to build this this curve, which essentially describes the parameters of the exercise. One of these parameters is the difficulty. So by using this data, we can plot this characteristic curve, and from this characteristic curve, we can actually get what was the actual difficulty of the exercise, as the history of its attempts has shown us. Now, we have evaluated this approach with the data set from the Saarland University of Applied Sciences. It was a bridging course that was taken in 2009. We had 74 exercises with 33 concepts in the domain model, about 400 students, and about 1,500 of events. The result actually much bigger than this slide, but interesting is that, so we here is a histogram of exercises. Difficulties. One thing which is an interesting side effect that we have discovered is that you can see that there is a huge peak for the difficulty equal to 1. What it means is essentially there is a large portion of exercises that no students have ever solved. So they have perfect difficulty. So maybe, of course, there's something with students, but maybe there is something wrong with exercises. So that's another kind of side effect that we have found. Another thing is that once we have recalibrated our difficulty based on this data set, and then we try to test so how our model actually performs after that, we had a 30% accuracy increase in terms of predicting whether the student will be able to solve an exercise or not. That's not bad. 30% more effective modeling mechanism. And it's all fully automated. So actually, authors do not need to do anything here. It is fully based on the models and the information that already exists in our system. We didn't utilize them before. Example number two, semantic gap detection. And enabled technology here is Semantic Web. So, once again, for those of you who don't know, Semantic Web is the initiative that helps to create machine-readable web. It is based on a set of standards for representing information and knowledge on the web, usually XML-based standards. And set of standards for syndicating different services so that they can in an automated way process this. I risk repeating myself, but once again, I mean, so if we talk about metadata annotation, it is a very hard task. It's especially hard for non-expert authors because, well, they never did it before. They faced first time authoring for intelligent adaptive systems. So it is error prone, right, because it's done manually. It is time consuming. Because it's done manually. It is usually not very well supported with the current authoring tools. It is often involving lots of authors. So collaborative authoring effort many times is needed in order to create, let's say, a single course. And I will show you some numbers for that. Often these authors are not experts. And well, yes, it is difficult. Of course it is difficult. Now, just to demonstrate the magnitude of this problem on, once again, on an example of MassBridge. So within MassBridge, we have collected a very large collection of learning objects, right? So, and MassBridge has a very, not easy metadata schema, right? So overall, we have more than 30 metadata elements within MassBridge. Some of them are not really used in adaptive inference. Some of them are used for cataloging purposes, such as who is the author, what is the language, what is the date of creation. But some of them actually are used by the intelligent components of the system. And the collection of content from MassBridge is more than 1,000 learning objects. square multiply 1,000 by 30. This is basically the air space for the space to make an air, right? Another thing is more than 50 people were involved in creating this quantum. That's how this also multiplies the problem. So once again, if you take a look at the problem in more details and try to decouple what actually is the problem here. Well, there is a certain mismatch. So when authors create metadata, they're not restricted in any way. They're not supported in any way. They're not formally supported or restricted, right? So basically, when this metadata is used by the system, then it is used in a very restricted and formal way by the intelligent components of the system in order to produce, well, intelligent results in terms of adaptive learning. So this mismatch in terms of authoring restriction and metadata usage restriction, this is the source of potential gaps in metadata, potential inconsistencies in how metadata is created and then used. And along with the data element, well, it can result in many things. It can result in system failure. It can result in ineffective learning. Well, but basically nothing good can come from it, right? Another thing is that students, they are a very particular category of users. We really don't want them to get confused. They are very much susceptible to the failures of the system and can rarely recover from them on their own. So if the system, the intelligent system, provides them an effective learning path, they will just fall on the path. Either they will receive an effective learning or they may just quit the system altogether because it is boring or makes them anxious or for any other reason. So what is the solution? Solution is to actually externalize these restrictions in metadata authoring, is to make them obvious, to make them formal, represented as an ontology, and induce some standard semantic web tools, such as semantic web reasoners, to detect metadata gaps as logical inconsistencies in this semantic base of content. You don't need to understand what we have here, but this is essentially the snippet of the ontology that we have created for the sake of to represent the Madrid metadata schema, right? So we have all the types of learning objects here, all kinds of restrictions, all kinds of properties. So when representing them in this way, we can not only, for example, say that a certain learning object can be connected with a certain relation to another learning object. We can say something more. So for example, if an exercise has a prerequisite concept, then the same exercise cannot be connected to this concept with a relationship outcome. Right? So these restrictions, they exist in the system. And when system generates courses for students, it actually uses these restrictions, but they have never been available for the authors when they created metadata. So now we have them. And once we have them, we have this very simple four-step procedure to verify whether the content has gaps or not, and then communicate these gaps, if we found them, to the author. So the first step, so we have our original content combined with some transformation rules in order to represent them as an ontology. And then through XLT processor, this XLT is another standard semantic web technique, we basically have this content transformed into the ontological language, into the OWL. This is web ontology language. On the second step, once we have it all represented as an ontology, we now actually can rely on the domain reasoner, semantic web reasoner, to find these gaps for us. Because now it will find these gaps as logical inconsistencies in the ontology. That's what they are built for. So for example, we have two learning objects, neutral by 12 and XORDFL, for the lack of a better name. And then these two learning objects are connected to each other with the relation has domain prerequisite. So the inter by flow has domain prerequisite XOR. Now we know something more about these two things. We know that inter by flow is of type instructional text. And we know that XOR is of type example. And we also know something about this particular relation because we have actually put this knowledge in the ontology. We know that this relation can be applied to objects of type text. But the subject of this relation can be only the concept item. So only a particular concept can be prerequisite for a text. And XTOR is not a concept item, it's an example. So this situation creates inconsistency, which is automatically detectable by the semantic web reasoner. Now, once we have these gaps detected, what next? Because, so we have found that this particular place in the content has a gap. What can we do with this? Under the hood, it's all a bunch of XML. We need actually to find a way to communicate these gaps to the author so that the author can find some options how to resolve these gaps. So the next step, we isolate the axiom that affects actually causing these gaps. So this text is what these gaps look like, content-wise. So once we find that, once the semantic web reasoner finds that we have some gaps in this particular place, we know which part of XML code is causing them. And once we have it, what we can do, we can translate this XML in a more readable explanation. So in this particular case, we, for example, translate that, well, what this means, this piece of XML, it means that the text improvised flow says that I might correct this XTOR, but the XTOR is a type example. And it shouldn't be. It should be of the type concept item, because only this particular type can be applied to the relation as the main prerequisite. Now, this is already human readable somewhat, right? And once again, everything is done in automated way by the logic which we have already in the system. So when we evaluated this particular mechanism, we ran it through the entire content base of MathBridge. And MathBridge, it was a European project with a budget of $3.5 million. And lots of budget, large part of the budget has been allocated for content offering. Experts in Bayesian mathematics, authors of actually of the content that we entered into MathBridge, they have spent lots and lots of time on entering this content into the system, verifying that the system is correct, that the content is correct, and so on and so forth. And after these experts have done their job, we run this thing. And what we found is, so you need to look at this to columns, that we still have lots and lots of gaps. So for some of the collections, we have more than 1,500 gaps. And not all of these gaps are just, you know, just repetitions of the same simple mistake. We actually have a lot of unique gaps too. So once again, fully automated solution of a complex problem. Just to show you that we actually are trying to implement this solution as a part of a friendly user environment. So this is a screenshot of MathBridge offering tool. And on the right here, you can see the result of the gap detection program. So the author has been creating a particular method for the MathBridge, and he has connected it with the relation domain prerequisite to an example. And once again, he cannot do this because example cannot be domain prerequisite, only concept can. That's what the system tells the author. Now the author actually can go back to the metadata that he provided for this particular union object and correct it. And the gap will not be in the content anymore. So to conclude, developers of adaptive intelligent learning systems in general should do much better job in terms of supporting non-expert authors creating content for their systems. Otherwise, we can never reach a wider adoption of these technologies in the real classrooms, in the real learning situations. The system's intelligence can be leveraged to provide such support. Systems, most of the systems already have enough knowledge, enough semantics, enough models to, when some smart techniques are applied, support tedious offering tasks. So technologies actually are becoming available. So we've been using educational data mining and semantic web. Social web technologies can be used as well. And I believe that in this particular direction, the offering bottleneck problem could be, well, if not solved, but at least a little bit alleviated. Thank you.